Fletch, you know that I'm the better fighter. Always have been, always will be.
I love this place. It's peaceful, beautiful, calm. The lights of all the stars around me, casting their light as I rest and grow stronger. They told me that one day I was going to do something amazing, something great. When I was strong enough, they would send me down to a new world so that I could help save it. But first, I'd have to get stronger. I'd have to bathe in the light of the stars, letting their power help me grow. I can't wait for that day to come, when I use my power to help this new world they told me about. But at the same time, I'm scared that I'll never see this place again. A deep voice fills my mind as I rest, one that I know well. He's the one that first created me. I do not know his name, only that he is far away, but his light shines the brightest of all. My child, remember that your trials are great. We have given you the knowledge you need to survive, the power to win, and our faith that you will always hold on to your light. Never let the darkness take hold of you. If you do, it will mean the end of everything that we are trying to protect.
I wanted to tell him that I'll do whatever I can to make him proud of me, but I have no voice. Not yet. I do know that he can feel the emotions bellowing out of my being. His light and power seem to brighten and grow stronger, filling me with what I can only imagine is approval. I take it in happily, but something's wrong. What is this new feeling flowing through me? It's not an emotion from the other lights around me, or from my creator. No, it feels hot. The lights around me start to dim, and I can hear anger coming from my creator.
No! Not yet! She's not ready! No!
I'm afraid as I feel my being pulled away from the great place that I love. A new feeling flows through me. A feeling that I've only been told about before, but never felt. Pain. The world around me goes dark, and I feel myself being pulled towards something. I get a quick glimpse of a world I've never seen before. One that is full of magic, but also pain and suffering. Now I find myself in what can only be said as a sort of room. I'm trapped inside of a glass dome, looking out at ponies. The word just popped into my mind. A couple of them in white coats. Another was colored a dark gray and stood very tall with a scar over his left eye. There was an even taller pony who had wings and a horn. She was dark blue, with a mane that looked like it was filled with stars. Last was a blue mare who was smiling at me through the glass dome.
Captain! It worked! We were able to capture a true child of the stars!
The blue mare said.
The scarred pony looked at her. Are you sure? All I see is a ball of light.
The mare with the flowing mane backed up a little.
She is right, Nightstalker. I have felt this kind of magic before. This creature is a child of the stars. It's different than I felt before, but similar at the same time. Are you sure this will work in your experiments, Minette?
I'm quite sure, Princess Luna. If my calculations are correct, we can use her power to make you into Nightmare Moon again, only this time with more control,
the blue mare said. The mare with the flowing mane looked closer at me in my dome.
I hope you are right, because if you're not, then bringing back Nightmare Moon could be worse than what we're already facing.
What will happen to this child of the stars if you are to succeed? The scarred stallion spoke next.
Vermont Minette told me it will die. You need all of its power to make this work. Minette, which constellation did you find this thing in?
I'm not sure, Captain, but from the readings, I think it came from the Aquila constellation? They were the brightest in that region when they turned on the machine,
the blue mare replied.
I'd die.
What does that mean?
Whatever it is, I don't like the sound of it. Where am I? Why can I feel so much pain and despair around me? It was like this entire world was suffering from so many emotions. Most of them were pain, hatred, anger, greed, and so much more. I had to know more. I needed to make them understand that they needed to let me go. I have something I need to do.
He Using the power that made up my body, I made my thoughts known to the ponies outside of the room.
Who are you? Why am I here?
They all looked at me in amazement. One of the mares in the white coats asked.
Did that thing just speak?
The blue mare responded.
I believe it did. I didn't think they could do that.
Isn't this just a mass of light magic?
Let me out of here. I'm not supposed to be here,
I said. The scarred stallion grinned a little.
You're where you're supposed to be, monster. You're here in this lab so that your power can be used to help us win this war our land is stuck in.
But my creator said I was meant to save the world.
You will, by giving up your power to our princess, he said.
That's not what I'm meant for,
I said as new ideas started to come to my mind.
I need a body, one that can handle my power so that I can save this new world. One that I can control. If you take my power, I won't be able to do that.
I said, feeling a strange feeling building up inside of me.
He rolled his eyes, turning towards the blue mare. Make it stop talking. We should extract its power as soon as possible.
Nightstalker, I'm not sure it'll be as easy as you think. The Children of the Stars is more powerful than we anticipated.
The mare with the flowing mane said.
She's right, sir.
A mare in the white coat said.
I think we need to shut it down before it overloads the system. This dome can barely hold the power as it is, and we're still pulling in more.
Minette made most of the equipment here. Everything will be fine. Kill that thing and take its power,
the scarred stallion said. That feeling I know now had to be rage. I let it fill me as I used my mind to yell at them.
I will not let you take what is mine!
I let the power inside me flow out. The blue unicorn backed away, yelling,
Shut it down, now!
Before the ponies could do anything, the dome around me cracked, and my power flowed out, making one of their silly machines explode, killing the two mares that were closest to the dome. The room started to shake, and more machines started to spark and smoke. I felt myself starting to laugh as I said,
You're all fools to try and contain me. You'll pay for what you've done!
The mare with the flowing mane jumped in front of the other two, yelling, Get behind me, both of you! I know how to stop her! I started to let my power build again.
You think you have the power to stop me? I'll show you how wrong you are!
A look of sadness came over the mare's face as the horn on her head started to glow.
I am sorry, child, but you have too much anger inside of you. Sleep and find peace in the land of dreams.
I was about to show her how wrong she was when her horn flashed and I felt my power pushed back into my being. Then the sights around me started to fade. It was like my mind was being pushed into a place similar to the one I had come from. Only the pain and hurt around me never went away. I could still hear what was going on around me. I could still feel the fear of the ponies felt as they saw how powerful I was. Still the feeling of pain of so many creatures in the land. Before my mind fully slipped away, I heard the mare with the flowing mane say,
Nightstalker, I want this place sealed. That spell will only keep her down here for a little while. Once we are out of here, I'll show Minette how to seal this room and keep her contained. I told you this was a bad idea. I want you to make sure no pony ever finds her.
The scarred pony started to say, But Princess Luna, I know that with a little more study, we can make it work.
I said, seal it!
Yes, Princess Luna.
I swore right then and there.
I'm going to make them pay for trapping me here and taking me away from my home.
I jumped as I woke, looking around, wondering where I was at. My heart was racing from that strange dream. Or was it a dream? It took me a moment before I realized I was still laying in the bed at the Lucky Horseshoe. I brought a hoof up to rub my temples slowly as a headache started to build in the back of my skull. Then I felt a talon on my shoulder. Looking over, I saw Aura looking up at me.
You all right, Shadow? You kicked me in your sleep.
Oh, sorry about that. I think so. I just had a really bad dream, I said, laying back down and letting Aura pull me close to her.
What kind of dream?
She asked as she started to run her talons through my mane. I really have no idea. It was like I was reliving the moment when Aquila first was pulled down to Equus.
Maybe with you pulling on her power like you did, you're starting to see some of her own memories, just like she can with yours.
I shrugged. I guess it's possible, though I hope I don't see any more. It's really hard to hate her when I see stuff like that. It was like torture and losing my mind at the same time.
That sounds awful. But I think, even though something like that can make you feel sorry for her, Aquila shouldn't be allowed to get out. There's no telling what she'd do if she did. I also don't want to lose you to something like that.
Aura said solemnly. I sighed. I guess you're right. She since spent centuries in the laboratory alone. Something like that would drive most ponies insane. There's something about her, though, that confuses me. She doesn't seem insane. There's been different times that I've interacted with her, and she seems like an insane monster, and others, she seems like a manipulative villain with some ulterior motive.
Really? How so?
Aura asked. Well, there was a time when she first emerged during that fight with your father and the Steel Rangers, when she was like a mad evil force. Then there was the time when we met those brothers, Squirrel and Moose, where she acted like an insane version of me. Then there was the time that I was on the town outskirts of Crimson Canyon, where she was appearing as a hallucination and acting like a somewhat of a normal pony, but stranger in a sense, I explained. Aura looked lost in thought for a moment.
I don't think she's insane. She just wants us to think she is. I don't know why, though. When I was doing medical training, I read a book about psychology, and what she sows matches a mix of psychopath and sociopath. The psychopath part is basically that she doesn't care about the feelings of others, but puts up a false facade to protect herself, and the sociopath part is that she really doesn't care about any kind of rules and will do whatever she wants to get what she wants, no matter what consequences befalls anyone who gets in her way. The best way to describe it is that she neither has true feelings nor a conscience. Well, she has feelings, but not really any for others, just of herself.
The weirdest part of all that is that I actually understood all that. She laughed a little.
You're not stupid. At least, not that stupid. Anyhow, I think we should get up.
But why? I'm comfortable.
I'm sure you are. But you're laying against me, and I really gotta pee,
she replied. Oh, go ahead and get up. I'll be out in a minute. Aura got out of bed and headed towards the bathroom as I stretched and tried my best to get up the motivation to leave the comfortable confines of this bed and all of its benefits. Warmth, the soft gentleness of the sheets that held me in its warm embrace. The squishiness of the mattress and the plushness of the fluffy pillow I laid my head upon. I decided to turn back on my side and lay in bed for a few more minutes to rest my eyes some more, until my face rolled onto a cold spot of the pillow. I quickly jumped back to see the most of the other side of the bed and grabbed my cheek with a hoof. There was a wet spot on the pillow where my face was. I didn't cry like a sissy. I know I am in my sleep, did I? I reached out and touched the spot with my hoof. Quickly, I retracted it.
Ew.
I drooled. Gross. I went out into the living room where everyone else was eating breakfast. Actually, no one was eating breakfast. Aura was trying to break up Wingnut and Bite as they fought over a book, a box of sugar apple bombs. And Windthrasher was staring at Stardust as he was being indecisive about what he wanted to eat out of the pantry. I walked to the couch, plopped down, and thought about what the hell I should eat. As I thought, a forgotten memory came back to me from a dream that I had a while ago, but I couldn't remember. What are you doing, Shadow? Stardust asked as he sat down next to me, munching on something crunchy, talking with his mouth full. Gross. I want some fucking waffles, I replied plainly. What? I said, I want waffles. Every pony in the wasteland either eats 200-year-old packaged pre-made food or something mutated that they killed or grew. I want something fresh and uncompromised by radiation. I also want something from a happier time, I replied. He looked at me quizzically for a second. Okay then. Waffles sound good. I think I saw some waffle mix in the pantry. Sure, it's still packaged and 200 years old, but it's the closest you're going to get to the real thing.
I guess so, but how are we supposed to get the mix into a waffle shape?
He smirked and rolled his eyes. Duh. We add what it says to the directions on the back of the box and put it in a waffle iron. Which we don't have. Ah, shit. Yep, mornings suck. I think I'll just have cereal. I looked over at Wingnut and Bite as they stared each other down while scarfing on their bowls of cereal in front of them. Are they racing to see who finishes first? Is that another one of their smartness tests? It's not really going to say who's smarter, just who's fatter in the sense that they eat a lot. I got up and walked over to them. If you two puke all over the place because you ate too fast, I'm going to make you clean up each other's mess. However, if one of you does and the other doesn't, they can make fun of the other. I said as I levitated most of the empty box of sugar apple bombs.
Says the one whose stomach is weaker than both of us.
Wingnut teased as Bite snickered. Ever since Bite joined us, they've both been pissing me off more and more. Mornings aren't my time, and they were about to learn that first hoof. While I was still levitating the box of cereal, I balanced on my hind legs, raised my forehooves, and slammed them down in front of both of their bowls. They both stared at me in awe as soggy cereal stuck to their faces and Brahmin milk dripped down from their chins.
Happy now?
I said as I turned and went back to sit on the couch.
Gee, Shadow, did you really have to do that?
Windthrasher asked.
No,
but maybe it'll make both of them think before they open their mouths and piss me off when I haven't been up for more than an hour.
You're not a morning pony, are you?
She asked. Not in the slightest. Later on, we all went down to the strip, which in the morning was a little bit of a weird sight every time I saw it. There were no neon lights lit up or anything, just ponies everywhere drunk, hookers offering their services, and Sakura ponies rolling around patrolling. Now that I was fed and completely woken up, I had calmed down a lot. Stardust said I was something called hangry, which meant that I was irritable because I was hungry. But I think that goes for any pony who hasn't had food for an extended period of time. We were going to JetBlue Skyport, but first needed to get a pass to get in to the NLR embassy. However, before we could get out of the casino area of the strip, one of the hookers approached us and went up to Stardust. She looked a little strange for a mare, and I soon found out why. With a somewhat deep voice, she said,
Hey baby, you looking for a good time? Because I got a nice big surprise for you if you want it like I want yours.
What? Stardust said like he wasn't sure if he should have said something or just walked away.
If you show me yours, I'll show you mine. And we can play a game for whoever gets to be the bottom. But I might cheat.
The hooker replied.
Stardust gagged.
Fuck no! He started a comically dry heave. Without a beat, Wingnut blurted out,
Tool time!
Then Bite said,
Yeah, you'll love it. It's all in a good fun.
When Stardust recovered from his gagging fit, he replied to the hooker, Get away from me before I do something that'll get me vaporized by the Sakura ponies. But if you're looking for some action, there's a stallion right up your alley in Freedom. If you meet him, I mean literally. Oh, and one more thing. Looking like a mare doesn't make you a mare. It makes you a liar. The hooker took his hoof and slapped Stardust across the face.
You could have just said no, asshole.
No, what I could have said was eat a dick, but that's pretty much your job description, and I thought you might get the wrong idea. Stardust retorted. As the hooker stormed off, he said,
It's called tolerance, asshole. Learn how to use it.
Stardust, he... she... It's right. You could have been nicer. What's the big deal if he likes to cross-dress? I said. He sighed. It doesn't bother me that he's a cross-dressing gay hooker. I say, do and like whatever you like. Just don't offer sex to some pony in front of younger ponies like these two. I know they're not young, but it's still immoral. Aura burst out laughing.
You're seriously concerned about morality here, of all places? That's the funniest thing I've heard in a while.
She wiped a tear from her eye.
It's almost as funny as that pony who thought he was a ghoul.
You still could have been nicer,
Windthrasher said shyly.
I guess you're right. But on the strip, some of the prostitutes try a little too hard to get work, and don't leave you alone. I figured if I could offend him, he'd at least leave me alone for good.
Stardust replied. Bite smiled.
Yeah, or come back with all of his gender-bent friends and fuck you up in more than way. Wastelanders are spiteful in that way. I kinda love it.
Stardust gave her a slightly horrified look.
Remind me to never make you angry. You're a creepy little shit.
She huffed.
Hey, that's what the other ponies used to say about me in Trotston. I'm not creepy. You're creepy, you big stinky bug.
I'll have you know, I showered in the other bathroom this morning. Last time I checked, you were the one who still has grease marks on her because she hasn't bathed yet. Who stinks now? I bet you don't even need those ties in your mane to keep it in pigtails.
Stardust said, defending his cleanliness. She turned to Wingnut.
Hey, dummy bug, do I stink?
He leaned forward to sniff her when she pushed his head away.
I didn't say smell me, freak!
Wingnut looked confused.
But what? I don't know what to say. Someone help me.
Aura snickered.
Something tells me you've never had a mare friend before, Squirt. Just say she doesn't stink to make her happy. And she'll continue liking you for now, until you fail at one of her next tests of loyalty and she moves on.
Bite scoffed.
I don't like him!
Aura put on her sinister face.
Denying it doesn't prove anything. All it does is prove the opposite. I thought you were supposed to be smart.
Oh yeah? At least I'm not as primitive as you and cockadoodle sunshine.
Bite retorted.
Why, you little shit.
Aura said right before I grabbed her to stop her from strangling Bite. Can we just please get to the embassy so we can get past and get into the JetBlue Skyport? I asked, still trying to hold back Aura as Bite hid behind Wingnut and stuck her tongue out at her. Stardust gave me a funny look.
Pass?
Yeah, don't we need some pass or something to go in there? It's all guarded and stuff, like the strip. I replied.
We don't need anything like that. We don't even need to go through Freedom to get to the Skyport. There's a monorail that goes directly near there to the embassy. JetBlue Skyport is like all other NLR encampments. You can just go right in, and as long as you don't cause any trouble, you won't get shot.
Stardust explained. Oh, I said, surprised. Isn't that kind of stupid?
Well, yeah, but not having a piece of paper isn't going to stop some pony from going in there to cause mischief. Plus, it's filled with NLR ponies of almost every rank.
Stardust replied. Okay then, I guess we're going to go to the monorail station, I said as I let go of Aura. We started on our way to the station, and I noticed Wingnut looking a little more nervous. What are you looking at? He asked. Me? Oh, nothing. I'm just shaking like a leaf. I replied.
I am not,
he retorted. As he walked closer to me, he said quieter.
I don't really want to go on the monorail.
Wow, was Wingnut actually afraid of something that isn't the dark? I thought I'd never see the day that he wouldn't want to ride on a strange machine. Why don't you want to ride the monorail?
It's just a train. It runs on electricity and nothing else. It's a 200-year-old computer, regulated by the power in that thing, and I really don't like it.
He interrupted. I really thought I'd never see the day that Wingnut wouldn't trust a computer. It'll be fine. I'm sure the NLR maintains it well enough.
You don't get it, he sighed. The monorail runs on an electric motor controlled by an old computer. Electric motors work differently than regular steam, combustion, and gem-powered motors. With those other motors, they have a way to work up to their maximum speed. With an electric motor, all that power is available right away. If the computer malfunctions, or something else happens to it, We could be shot down the track at breakneck speed and cause the rusted mounds of track to collapse and send the train careening to the ground, killing us all!
Oh well, I said, trying to keep my cool as I internally freaked out. At least the first part will be fun, like those roller coasters they used to have before the war.
I see how it is. You're scared too,
he said. Nuh-uh, I quickly retorted.
R2, maybe you're right though. I shouldn't be worried if I'm with you. You are somehow realistically unlucky. And this is one of those times where you're gonna do something potentially dangerous and come out without a scratch,
Wingnut said in a snarky tone. As I started walking up the steps led to the station, I thought about what he was saying. When have I ever done something stupidly dangerous and come out without at least getting a gunshot wound? Then, right as I went through the door and up the stairs, I was met with a face full of water. I wiped off my face with a hoof and thought back to the first time I experienced this wondrous phenomenon. When I looked up in front of myself after getting the water out of my eyes, I saw the two ponies I expected, Squirrel and Moose. Do you guys do that to everyone, or just me? Moose smiled sheepishly. Sorry, it's just a precaution. We saw you coming up the stairs and you weren't wearing the ward we gave you, so we figured you might have somehow gotten possessed. Nice to see you too. I'll bring up my own religion water next time and we can have a splash fight, I replied. You're damn right, it's nice to see us. We heard about your little incident in Appleton. What the hell happened? We gave you that horn ring specifically to stop something like that from happening, Squirrel said, sounding a bit irritated. Before I could answer, Bite asked excitedly,
Who are you?
It was at that point Squirrel went from tough guy to butter in Bite's hooves. Oh, hello to you, sweetie. My brother and I hunt monsters. Bite smiled and closed her eyes cutely.
Oh, I get it. You're idiots!
Squirrel froze, and the look on his face went, what was just priceless. Like someone just punched him in the stomach. Moose spoke up before his brother sounded like more of a hopeless moron in front of the genius. Not typical monsters. We hunt cryptoids. Monsters that show up in folklore and sometimes also the wasteland. The supernatural kind of the monsters like demons, ghosts, vampires, wraiths, homunculi, etc. She smiled again.
So you're not just nutjobs, you're huge idiot nutjobs. Those things don't actually exist. They're all just things made up of ponies to scare us wussies like Wingnut into being afraid of the dark.
With a flick of my hoof, I gave her what Vervain used to call a brain duster.
Bite, shut up. There's a very good reason he's afraid of the dark. There's no need to be a brat.
I looked back at Squirrel, who was still frozen in disbelief that something so adorable could be so mean. Appleton was destroyed by a laser shot from a satellite, not by Aquila. He snapped out of his confusion.
That's funny, because I'm pretty sure eyewitnesses' reports from multiple witnesses don't lie. Also that you and Pride were both using powerful magic to fight each other. The kind of magic you were using wasn't anything but normal for a unicorn. So tell us, when did you start helping that thing?
Okay, fine. I used Aquila's power, but we came to a mutual understanding that both of us wanted to keep on living,
I said, defending myself, while at the same time putting my own hoof in my mouth.
You do realize that letting yourself give in to Aquila could make her stronger, right? Plus, I'm pretty sure there was another way you could have gotten rid of Pride,
Moose said.
Actually, that whole thing was a giant misunderstanding, and I didn't actually kill Pride, I replied.
Squirrel looked immediately shocked.
So you're saying that the homicidal freak is still out there somewhere?
Yeah, it turns out he's Orichalcus, my uncle.
A little piece of him survived and hid in my shadow for a while so he could heal himself. After a while, he became our ally. Well, my ally. Not too long ago, he was taken captive by my mother, who's also a bad pony, I replied with a sheepish smile.
Moose looked intrigued.
Orichalcus? Interesting. Do you know how he manipulates the shadows like he does? Squirrel and I have been trying to figure out how he does it, and learning how that he does it to be used to get a original pony, you know, kind of to help narrow it down.
Well, this is craptastic. I don't know if I should tell them how he used his magic or how he got his abilities. I know I can trust them, but what I don't know is what they'll do to him. Either they'll be interested like total geeks and try to figure out a way to fix him and make him normal, or they'll try to figure out a way to kill him because they're hunters and that's what they do. I guess it's 50-50 shot. He doesn't manipulate shadows. He is the shadows. He gained his abilities after studying the works of King Sombra. The ruler of the formal Crystal Empire? I knew he was a powerful sorcerer, but I didn't know he was that well in depth with arcane sciences. Moose said, scratching the back of his head as if he was trying to think harder about it. I wonder if there's any way we could get the texts he studied. It would help us immensely in our work. There's still a crazy murder on the loose and you're worried about books? Squirrel asked angrily. We gotta forget about that thing, a JetBlue Skyport, and kill its dick. Okay, first of all, he's my uncle. Second of all, what thing at the Skyport? I said, getting a little irritated at Squirrel's disregard for my feelings. Moose looked at his brother, then at me. We were just on our way to JetBlue Skyport to take care of something. There'd been reports of the NLR trainees and soldiers going missing recently, and they cleared debris from the entrances of the old basement. Squirrel and I think there's something down there taking them out. Cool. Stardust blurted out, then looked around nervously. Well, I mean, not cool. Pony's dying is bad and all, yeah.
Have there been any confirmed deaths?
Windthrasher asked. It was just then that they both realized that she wasn't normal and Squirrel put out his gun.
Hey, you're that thing that was flying around all those places making ponies uneasy,
he said as he started to lower his gun.
And you talk like a normal pony and haven't tried to kill us yet.
As he reholstered his gun, he said,
I think this is actually the first time we haven't been attacked after seeing something, unique like you in the wasteland.
I'm glad I could be here first.
Winnesha said, right before turning bright red.
I didn't mean first, like, first, I meant...
Yeah, we get it. Keep your fur, scales, or whatever you're covered in on. You know, it's cute that you get embarrassed like that.
Squirrel said, interrupting.
Anyway, we should get to the JetBlue Skyport and take care of whatever monster's in there.
Moose said as he and the monorail arrived at the station. Whatever monster was ailing the Skyport couldn't interfere with what I needed to do there. I quickly went over some options and scenarios in my head and said, I could help you guys if you want. Maybe I'll learn a thing or two and be prepared if I see something like this so-called monsters in the wasteland and need to kill it. They looked at each other, then back at me, and the squirrel said,
An extra hoof couldn't hurt. But not all of you can come with us. It's dangerous enough as it is.
Stardust and I fought up a horde of ghouls once, so it could just be me and him going down there with you. I said, volunteering one of my friends once again to do something that's probably stupid and more than likely deadly. Stardust crossed his hooves.
No way, Kimosabi. I'm not going to the dark, dank basement with a possibly bloodthirsty monster on the loose. I still have flashbacks to Stable 9.
No offense, Windthrasher.
None taken,
Windthrasher said quietly. Aura, are you going to go with me? I asked. She shook her head.
I'm in the same boat as Stardust, Shrimp. Too many bad memories of being in a dark, confined space with hungry beasts. Also, I'm a little pissed you didn't volunteer me before Stardust, but I guess that's okay. I'll just hound you for it later.
I wasn't even going to ask Bite, but she said something anyway.
Don't look at me.
Nope, P-Bug.
I'm not an idiot like you.
I'll go,
Wingnut said out of the blue. Before I could say okay, Squirrel raised a hoof.
Absolutely not. No offense, kid, but you're a kid. And I like sleeping at night, knowing I didn't willingly let a kid get mauled by a vicious, bloodthirsty, pony-eating monster that lives in the bone-covered basement of a skyport.
He's not that much younger than I am, and he's been in some pretty tough fights with me in the past. I know he can hold his own, I argued. Squirrel smirked like an arrogant jackass.
That's nice and all that you want to be nice and talk him up, but there's a good chance he could die, and I don't want that on my conscience. If the scary bird wants to come with us, or if your other friends grow a pair, that's fine. But I can't in good conscience let a kid go in there with us.
I looked closer at him and whispered in his ear. Listen, he's almost as good as I am in a fight, and I know he'll be fine. I think him volunteering is his way of trying to repress that mean little brat standing next to him. If you let him go with us, I can probably figure out a way to get him out of there before we even get in there, really. After I backed away from his ear, he stood there and thought for a minute as I looked at Wingnut and Bite.
Fine, kid, come on. Gotta train the next generation of hunters someday.
Aura shook her head next.
I'm sorry, but I have to step in on this one. I'm not gonna let Wingnut go down there. I'm his bodyguard, and I can't let him go into a place like that where he'll get hurt.
Wingnut looked back at her.
I don't need you to go with me. I'm ordering you to stay here with Bite, Windthrasher, and Stardust.
You can't order me to stay behind when you're going someplace dangerous. I have to go with you, and since I'm not going to go down there, I'm not letting you go either. It's part of the contract,
she said.
I think you forgot something in your contract, Dora,
he said, pulling it out from his saddlebags, unrolling it and pointing to a spot on it.
It says, and I quote, if the contract holder finds themselves in a situation that I cannot follow or help, then as long as the contract holder is with another griffin or pony that can help them keep safe, said griffin or pony will act as temporary bodyguard in my place. Damn it. I knew that would come back to bite me in the ass one day. Fine. Since Shadow's with you, then she'll serve as my place. Besides, I'm not going down there.
We all rode the monorail to JetBlue Skyport, and thankfully it didn't load or come derailed and crash like Wingnut thought it would. But I had a feeling he was worried about something else now. Since we got off the train, he's been a little jumpy with sudden sounds. When we arrived at the Skyport, the others asked why we needed to go there in the first place, and I remembered that I didn't tell them that I needed to talk to the captain I met at Crossroads Trading Post. It was just Wingnut and I now. The others went to go find other things to occupy their time. Stardust was showing trainees how to properly shoot. Aura was watching ponies spar, and Cookie Bite was sitting in a cell after hacking an officer's terminal and making a pornographic picture spam the screen. I didn't know where the hell Squirrel or Moose went. Something about there being pie and beer somewhere. Looking back to Wingnut, I asked, so, Wingnut, why'd you volunteer to come with me down there with Squirrel and Moose? Trying to impress Cookie Bite?
Ew. Gross. No, nothing like that. When she teased me for being afraid of the dark, it seriously pissed me off. So I figured if I face my fear head on with some extra danger, I can get over my fear of the dark. I know it's dangerous and all, and you're probably going to find a way to leave him behind, but I have to do this. If I don't, I'll feel useless, like I did when my parents died. I couldn't help them at all when it happened. All I could do was hide and try to cover my ears so I didn't have to listen to their torment.
Sounds like an excuse to impress Cookie Bite to me, I laughed.
Shadow, I'm serious about this. No more jokes.
I put my hoof on his head and ruffled up his mane. I know how serious you are about this.
Then why are you teasing me?
Because it's easy to. He looked away and pouted.
That's not funny, Shadow.
I sighed. Listen here, kiddo. I understand when I was a filly, I was afraid of a lot of things. I was still afraid of those same things when I grew up, and going out in the wasteland was terrifying. There are things that I'm still scared to death of out here. So listen, I don't know what we're going to be up against down there. I want you to listen to Squirrel and Moose's every word, and no running off to explore. If there's anything I've learned out here is that to face your fears, you can't just be strong. You have to be smart, too.
Did you get that off a box of sugar apple bombs or something?
I blinked, dumbfounded by his response. I shook my head and laughed. What? No. You silly colt. It's just something I've learned over time. I slugged his shoulder playfully.
That's fair. I do tend to disappear in dire situations. It's just sometimes my overwhelming curiosity takes over. There's times when I see something and need to inspect it closer to see how it's put together and how it works. But I think I can overcome that too. However, if I die down there, don't tell any of the others if you go back to the town I used to live in,
he said solemnly. Why not? He gave me a small smile.
I told Honeysuckle and some of the others that I wouldn't let any monsters get me. Honestly, it really freaked me out that time I got attacked by the plant thing in the mountains. Thought I was gonna die. Thank the goddesses that Dr. Cottage and the other doctors were able to help me. Especially 21. She was nice. And hot.
There it goes. The conversation turned from mature to immature, the turn of a cap. I blame Stardust for that. I muttered under my breath. Damn it, Stardust. I sighed again and shrugged. At least you said she was nice first. You're improving. If only a little.
You thought she was hot too. Don't say you didn't.
He retorted. I stammered a bit and looked around quick to make sure Aura wasn't close by.
Yeah, I did. But I think the zebra was better looking between you and me.
I like Dr. Cottage too.
Wingnut said, throwing my brain into an alternate tangent. He's not saying what he thinks he is, is he? I didn't turn him off to Mayors by accident, did I?
Wingnut, you saw Dr. Cottage, right?
Seriously, Shadow? You're dumber than you seem sometimes. That's not what I meant. What I meant was that he's like me. He sees things in the medical field like I see things in machines. There's also the fact that he's hilarious when he tells Pony the Cold our truth.
He replied. I'd get offended about him calling me dumb, but he did have a point. Plus, I think a little bit of bite is rubbing off on him, too.
I can see where you're coming from with that.
I just think he's an ass and a little creepy.
Who's an ass and a little creepy? Hope you're not talking about me.
Squirrel said from behind us. No, just some genius doctor we know. I replied. He gave a look like he didn't expect my answer. A lot of mayors must call him creepy or something.
Well, anyway, let's get going. The longer that thing's on the loose, the more ponies I will go missing.
Moose was standing behind him, holding a small beat-up journal in his magic.
I actually think I know what it is. From what I was told by Commander Redwood, they moved into the skyport fairly recently and sealed off the basement inside the building. Since the rate of missing soldiers and whatnot is slowly rising day by day, I assume it's a creature that grows in hunger when there's food readily available. There's also the fact that it only strikes at night, which gives us two things to think about, which is either nocturnal or that it just likes the dark. Either way, I don't think conventional weapons are going to work on this thing. There's a good possibility it could be a Wendigo.
Aren't Wendigos the cloud spirits that are supposed to create super cold weather? I read a book in my stable about the foundings of Equestria and Hearthswarming Eve. Moose stopped me when I said Hearthswarming Eve.
Not Wendigo. Wendigo, with an E, not an I. A Wendigo is a creature created by an evil spirit that preys on the weak-minded targets of a pony suffering from hunger. When the spirit does is possess the pony and the subconscious and turn them into a cannibal. Then said pony feeds on the flesh of another, and they start to lose their minds and eventually undergo a transformation into a monster that walks on blade-like legs, has gray skin with no fur, and a big mouth full of razor-sharp teeth.
Squirrel gave Wingnut an eye, strange-looking guns, and some flares.
Take these. That's the only way we'll be able to kill this thing.
Why can't we use our regular guns?
Wingnut asked.
Because fire's the only way to kill a Wendigo. Even if you do blow its head off with a shotgun, it'll eventually grow back and come back alive.
Squirrel answered, then explained.
Those are modified flare guns. They're attached to a small, highly compressed liquid fuel tank that'll spray out fuel at whatever you're aiming at. So when you shoot the flare, it'll burst into flames.
That's so fucking cool, I said without thinking. Moose sighed.
Sure, it's cool, but you both gotta be careful down there. Wendigos are extremely dangerous. They can hide and watch you without making a sound. They can also decapitate you as quickly as you can see them. There was a case we worked in the northwest near an old sanatorium in the woods. 8 ponies were taking shelter in an old cabin. They were hunted down one by one by 2 Wendigos. A few of them survived, but they were left traumatized by the experience. It's imperative that we stick together and don't get separated. Wendigos tend to pick off ponies one by one and keep them where they nest until they need to eat them or until they starve to death.
I didn't expect a simple monster to be so elaborate. Pretty terrifying that it can hunt you like that, I said, surprised.
Oh, not us. We're badasses. But you two, on the other hoof, are untrained amateurs and are more than likely to be mauled or dismembered, Squirrel said confidently. All right, then. Now that we all know what we're most likely to expect, shall we go?
We approached the entrance of the basement. I got close to Squirrel and whispered, I had a talk with Wingnut. I don't think we should let him go with us instead of making an excuse to leave him behind. He sighed.
Well, at least it'll be on your conscience and not mine. If he dies, save the tears for when we're safe and that thing is dead.
Don't worry. I will.
Also, there's another thing I forgot to bring up earlier.
He continued.
Don't think I didn't notice your changing colors. How long has Aquila been getting stronger?
Not too long. This color thing happened after I started doing this thing with a zebra named Yaksha, so I could take some of her power. I replied.
Damn it. That's the probably stupidest thing you could have done. A being like her is her power, and from what I've deduced, well, from what Moose has deduced, she's a bit of a trickster. If I were you, I'd stay away from her power as much as possible. She could be tricking you into slowly letting her take control, Squirrel said.
What are you guys talking about?
Wingnut asked. Oh, nothing, just some stuff about Aquila is all. Catching them up on what's been going on, I replied. We came to a hole in the wall that had either been blown open or just eroded over the years on the side of a main terminal. Looking down the hole, I was immediately creeped. It just went from daytime light to absolute darkness. How the hell are we supposed to see down there without lights? Can't we see about turning on the lights down there first before we go in? Moose gave a sorrowful look.
Sorry, but we can't. If we do that and turn on the lights down there, the Wendigo might dash out from where we came in and attack some pony out of fear.
Sure, it's a monster, but it's more or less like an animal with basic instincts. Fortunately, it's better for us to hunt us in the dark. Just thank the goddesses, it's daytime, so there's a good chance it might be asleep. Otherwise, it already knows we're here.
Do you at least have a flashlight?
Wingnut asked.
No, kid, all we got's our weapons, Squirrel said quietly. Having a flashlight around one of those things is like a painting a giant red target on your face. That's why I brought glow sticks.
Glow sticks? I asked.
Yeah. We crack them and scatter them around to make some light for ourselves, but not enough to irritate the indigo,
Moose explained. He seemed like an older and smarter one of the two. Squirrel seemed more brash and reckless, like he runs into danger without fear of the consequences. I had to ask, which one of you is the older brother? Squirrel cracked the glow stick and tossed it on the ground.
That'd be yours truly. Moose just drank his milk when he was younger and I didn't. That's his secret to being huge.
Not huge, Squirrel.
It's genes, not milk, Moose argued. Nah, you're huge. I remember Dad always having to poke fun at you when you were growing up.
Dad was also an ass, and he always obsessed over that stupid bat that killed gave Mom.
I remember when we were little, and he used to leave us all kinds of fucked up places, and he'd go on hunts.
He could have stopped hunting and spent some quality time with us like we were a real family, Moose said angrily. I noticed their voices were starting to get louder, so I stepped in before they got us killed. I get this is a touchy subject, but I really like living.
Right, they both said in unison.
Then I thought about what Moose said. What were you saying about a bat?
Oh, our father had this barbed wire covered bat he used to use wherever he could when he go hunting. Our mother gave it to him. Then she introduced him to hunting, and it was the first thing he killed a monster with, he answered.
I thought back to when I was wandering the Midwest. I remembered a pony out there with a barbed wire bat. I wonder if it's the same pony. Is his name Hex?
You know our dad?
Squirrel asked. I stammered a bit out of shock at how small the world really is. Yeah, sort of. I killed some ghouls with him once, wandering the Twin Cities area. Squirrel sighed as he cracked another glow stick and threw it.
At least we know he's alive out there somewhere. We've been looking for him for a while. He said he was going to go on a special hunt for something a while back, and that was the last time we heard from him.
I just met my father, and he's got...
What?
Moose asked. Shit,
I didn't think about the secret I'm supposed to be keeping. Fast. Think fast. A mustache. A giant curly mustache. Yeah, that's what he's got.
You feeling okay, Shadow?
Wingnut asked, sounding concerned.
Because I'm pretty sure that Nightshade doesn't have a mustache.
Damn it, Wingnut in his big mouth. Okay, maybe not all the time, but when he puts it... never mind, he doesn't have facial hair. He's just an important pony to the Enclave, that's all, and I thought you guys might hold it against me or something.
No, you've apparently met our father. Who do you think is worse, an Enclave officer or an angry drunk with a monster-killing fetish?
Squirrel replied with a wave of his hoof. That went better than expected. Can't believe I almost blabbed the secret of my father to the stranger. I know Squirrel and Moose wouldn't do anything to him if I had asked him to, but I just don't think Dad would appreciate me spreading around that information. At least my excuse was that stupid this time and not totally weird or disgusting. Looks like I'm finally growing a mind/mouth filter. You're probably right, he's not that bad.
Didn't you try to kill him in Winnapolis?
Moose asked. Have they been following me? Wait, no, of course they haven't. Stupid radio ponies have. No, my friend Stardust, when he was under the Enclave control. It's a long story, and I'd rather not get into it. I feel like we were down here for hours already and haven't heard or seen a thing. But I guess that's the thing with these kind of creatures. What am I supposed to be looking for?
I told you earlier what it looked like.
Moose answered.
I think she means what signs of nesting are we looking for, or whatever.
Wingnut clarified.
Bones. Definitely bones. The Wendigo will discard bodies closer to where it lives in its habitat. It's somewhat of a nesting thing.
Squirrel said.
Well, not exactly. It happens more with female Wendigos. Male Wendigos scatter discarded corpses around the area to confuse prey.
Moose explained further. Wingnut looked puzzled.
Male and female Wendigos? Can they mate and make a baby Wendigo?
Squirrel smirked and chuckled a bit.
Thank the goddesses, no. If they could do that, we'd have a much bigger problem on our hooves. Wendigos don't even like living with one another, unless they're siblings before they turned, or a couple of some sort. That was the case with the ones we hunted down before.
Why's that?
Wingnut asked.
I mean, I think I understand. It seems pretty simple. You wouldn't eat your best friend, but you'd help them kill to survive with you?
Wingnut asked.
Exactly. Most of the time, it's more of a previous bonding with Wendigos that inhabit the same space. I say most of the time because there's a small percentage of ponies who hate each other getting trapped somewhere without food, but still not getting eaten with each other no matter how insanely hungry they are. Morals can still play a big role in the turning point of a Wendigo, no matter how strong the spirit manipulating them is.
Moose replied. Crunch.
Shadow.
Wingnut said. I know. What was that? I asked.
I think it was a bunch of ribs.
He said, sounding a little shaken already. Suddenly, a screech filled the air around us. Moose and Squirrel jumped into action with their weapons ready.
Shadow, you and the kid should get yourselves ready,
Squirrel said quickly. We both got our flare gun things out as the screeching stopped. I looked around frantically, trying to figure out where the sound had come from. Did you guys see anything?
No, but I'm sure it's here. Don't make any movements that are too sudden. It'll see that you're trying to escape. Stay your ground. If it feels threatened, it'll hesitate to attack right away. And give us a chance to locate it,
Moose said, no longer talking quietly. I saw a flash out of the corner of my eye and tackled Wingnut to the ground as the hideous monster charged at him. As if in slow motion, I aimed the flare gun at it as it jumped over us, pulling the trigger. A spray of liquid came out all over the beast that splashed all around as it rolled along the ground and jumped away out of sight. Fuck! Where did it go? Wingnut, are you all right?
Yeah, I'm fine. Thanks, Shadow.
He replied quickly and got back to his hooves and readied his aim with the flare gun.
Come on, motherfucker!
Squirrel shouted.
We're primed and ready for extra crispy monster roast!
I didn't see movement from anywhere around us. It was like it vanished out of the thin air. Then I let my eyes wander upward and saw the Wendigo crawling on the ceiling above the brothers. Guys, above you! I yelled as I pointed the flare gun and fired. I was expecting a bright flash, but all that escaped the gun was a short combustive sound and the unlit flare. I watched in eternal horror as it bounced off its body and fell to the ground. The next thing I knew, the creature was atop me with its maw open wide and a screech. I froze, and when I got the sense to move, I realized that I hadn't had the chance to reload another flare. It closed its mouth and brought its ugly face within an inch of mine and took a deep breath, as if it was smelling me. In a very creepy way, it took its mighty claw and cut a gash into my cheek like it was marking me for death before taking me away to its lair. Before I could even think, why hasn't anybody shot this thing yet? Wingnut blasted it with a more accelerant and shot a flare its way, and coincidentally my way, which didn't make me feel all too comfortable. However, this time the Wendigo's back burst into flames. It jumped off me and started to roll and writhe in pain.
Got it!
Wingnut exclaimed. Right as Squirrel was about to give it another dose of liquid hot justice, it rolled just enough to put the fire out. Before it could shoot it, it lunged at him and slapped him against the support beam, knocking him unconscious.
Shit! Squirrel!
Moose yelled. The monster looked back at Moose, who was taking aim, and then turned back to Squirrel, grabbing his barding in his mouth and jumping back into the darkness.
Damn it!
Wingnut yelled.
Why didn't it die? I thought fire was supposed to kill it!
Moose looked a little panicked as he started to pace and take deep breaths.
It does kill Wendigos. We just underestimated its intelligence, this one. It knew how to put out fire, and now it's got Squirrel. We're just a nuisance to it now. It's got food to play with.
Great, so what now? I asked, starting to panic myself. Wingnut spoke before Moose had a chance to answer.
Easy. We track it.
How are we supposed to track something we can't see in here? I asked.
Hey Moose, toss me one of those glow sticks.
Wingnut said, surprisingly calmly. Moose grabbed one out of his saddlebags and threw one to him.
I have some radioactive material in my saddlebags with some other stuff I was going to use to mod some weapons. If I'm right, the chemicals in this glow stick should react to it and try and excrete the radiation through the light. All I gotta do is open the top of the glow stick after I pop it and pour some of the liquid in and add some of this stuff.
He started to shake the glow stick up and down, and he covered it again. The sickly green turned into a weirdest blue color.
There. Now we have some temporary ultraviolet light. If that thing doesn't heal super fast, we might be able to track this, using droplets of blood to trace its movements.
Wow, that's incredible. I didn't know you could do that with a glow stick.
Moose said, surprised as he... what he just saw Wingnut do.
I bet you're glad you brought me down here now, huh?
Wingnut said snarkily. Nice one, Wingnut. Though, I thought for a moment. Remember, it was set on fire. If it bled at all, it's most likely been sealed by the fire. I pointed out, trying my hardest not to crush him. However, he wasn't fazed by it.
When it was rolling on the ground, I guarantee you got stabbed or scraped on something.
He said, pointing a hoof and shining the light on the ground.
See? Right there. There's blood on the broken bottle. Looks already to be pretty deep.
I stand corrected, I said as I looked at the brightly glowing blood. He walked over to where Squirrel got taken from and shined the light, finding a trail of blood.
Gotcha, bitch!
We followed the blood trail for a while until it eventually went dry. We hadn't found Squirrel yet and were almost all out of glow sticks to drop. What possessed ponies to build such enormous buildings with no fucking windows in the basement? Houses have windows in the basement, I think. I wasn't really upset about the windows. It was just really dark down here, and I was starting to get to me. Being in the day, in the dark, with a pony-eating monster around me was more unsettling than being hunted by the sins in the light of day. To my surprise, though, Wingnut was unfazed by the darkness. Usually by now, he's more paranoid than I was. Not to mention, coming up with the idea of making the UV light out of the glow stick was genius. How did he even know how to do that in the first place? He must have done it another time somewhere else. What are we going to do if we run out of glow sticks? I asked. Moose sighed.
I don't know. We don't have any flashlights. Probably have to feel our way or start using our flares.
Then it just hit me, and I face hoofed. Of course, I exclaimed. What about my pit buck? We can use the light on it to see. I know it's dangerous because it'll make me more of a target, but
We can't aimlessly wander around in the dark. It's not stupid. It's moronic, however.
We don't have much of a choice, do we now?
It'll have to work, Moose said in a disappointing tone. I turned on my pip buck, and almost couldn't hold back a scream as I saw a hanging corpse in front of me. It was old. The skin was tight and blackened like an old scab. It was also pretty stinky. Not enough to make me gag anymore. It seems like the wasteland has conditioned me into being resistant to disgusting things. Does this mean we're close to its nest? I asked, disgusted.
Hopefully,
Moose answered. I shined my pip light around and saw dozens of bodies hanging upside down from the ceiling. The NLR really did invade this territory. There should be at least 80 to 90 bodies here. That's not counting the bones everywhere that we keep stepping on. How long do these things live for?
No pony really knows. Could be longer than a pony's natural lifespan,
Moose answered.
Why are some of the bodies untouched? I thought they were pony eaters,
Wingnut asked.
They are. This is strange. See, a corpse this decomposed is unusual with a Wendigo. Usually they eat their prey within a day or two, after either natural or inflicted death.
There's been something bugging me about this thing since we started this hunt. This is in a desert. Wendigos usually stick to mountains, areas, or woods, Moose said, looking around at the scattered bones. What could be different about this one? I asked.
I have no idea. It could be any number of things. The origins of where it turned, the radiation, the contact with taint. But it's most likely its place of origin.
The appearance of Wendigos is usually places in a small percentage. But it does happen. I just can't figure out its eating habits.
Wendigos never leave a body untouched.
Moose repeated as he pulled out a shotgun.
I thought regular weapons didn't work on Wendigos.
Wingnut asked. Moose loaded the shotgun.
They don't. These rounds are incendiary shells.
Why didn't you use that in the first place? I asked angrily.
Explosive shells. Squirrel doesn't like spending too much on these as it is. But he's not here right now,
Moose said, answering as he cocked the shotgun. Wingnut smirked.
He's gonna be pissed.
I'll get him a piece of pie and a beer later and he'll be fine. He can't stay mad when he's got pie,
Moose said.
I think I know how we can find Squirrel and the monster,
Wingnut said, looking at me in a way that told me I've been an idiot.
Shadow, you have a pick buck. Couldn't you use your EFS?
Of course he said that. I've been an idiot. All this time down here searching for that fucking thing, I didn't even think to check my readily available EFS at all. I looked away sheepishly. I honestly forgot about it. I haven't needed it that often. It might be a problem, though. There are ponies upstairs that could throw it off. I can't determine elevation.
You could look for the red line, stupid,
Wingnut said condescendingly. Wow, he's a ball of fire. Today just wasn't my day. I woke up with a spitty face. I had a crankier than usual morning. I didn't get my fucking waffles. And I got dragged into this when I was supposed to be talking to the NLR captain here. At least I wasn't getting shot at. Keep heading straight. The red line is that way.
Are you sure? They might have raider holding cells here or something upstairs,
Wingnut said. Right after he said it, the Wendigo jumped out of the shadows and on top of Moose.
I think she's sure!
I heard the blast from his shotgun and saw the monster weakly crawl off of him and slowly start to burn and flail. It jumped into the ceiling and then crawled away before I could spray with my accelerant.
Damn it!
It seemed I'd spoken too soon. I was suddenly once again on my back, using my magic to keep the monster from stabbing me through the face with one of its legs. This time, I wasn't going to let it make me its bitch. I took the flare gun with more of my magic and shot it off in the Wendigo's eye. It dropped off me and writhed on the ground, doing its best to grab its head as the flare burned inside. I took the gun and sprayed the accelerant, causing its whole body to burst into flames. It screamed and flailed on the ground, trying to put it out like it did before, until finally it stopped. Either the flare cooked its brain enough to temporarily disable it and let the flames do their work, or it succumbed to the flames themselves. Either way, it was dead.
Is it dead?
Wingnut asked as he stared at the burning corpse with a hoof over his nose. I was about to answer with a, "I'm pretty sure," but Moose beat me to the punch.
"Yeah, it's dead. It'll burn the whole body to ash."
"You did good, Shadow. You both did.
Hey, kid, that trick with the glow stick was absolutely genius. I'm glad you were able to hold your own and not panic."
I expected Wingnut to light up and get excited like he always did with praise. But he just said,
"Thanks and all. But Shadow did most of the work between the two of us."
"Modesty? What's going on with this kid today?" I checked my EFS again for signs of life to see if we could find a squirrel. Unfortunately, there were too many lines to determine if he was around anywhere, or even alive. "We should go in deeper into the nest area and see if we can find squirrel. I'm not picking up anything on my EFS right now." Then I saw a red line show up and disappear within a few seconds.
"Huh? Weird. What's weird?"
Moose asked. "Oh, nothing. I think there was just a minor glitch. Picked up a red line for a second on my EFS, but it's gone now." Moose still looked worried.
"Are you absolutely sure there's no way to hide from that thing?"
"Pretty sure. I've never had a problem in the past with it not detecting ponies and wasteland creatures," I replied, trying to reassure him.
"Listen, no offense to you or anything, but I'm gonna stay prepared.
There's still a chance that there's at least one more of those things down here with us. If we get caught off guard, we'll most definitely die because of it," Moose said, starting to get me to feel paranoid. I sighed. "Lead the way. Squirrel isn't gonna find himself." I think I could have worded that a bit differently. I shined my pip light in front of me again and began to walk closer to where I thought the epicenter of the bodies were. As I walked, I looked around a little with my light. I could see the basement area used to be where all the luggage was stored. There were broken conveyors and a few places hanging from small entry holes in the wall. "Do you guys think those conveyors led upstairs?"
"Of course they led upstairs. It's a skyport. The basement's where all the luggage is sorted for passengers. Those holes in the wall probably go out to the ticket counters up there,"
Moose replied. I thought about his answer for a moment, and how close to the nest of the area this was. "I don't think the Wendigo was going out through the way we came in to hunt for our victims. I think it was climbing up there and going through the conveyor entrances to bring them down that way."
"So, what does that matter?"
he asked. "It doesn't. I just thought..." when I was interrupted by Moose.
"What if it does? There are small gaps between the input areas and the ticket counters and the exit we can see down here. Enough of large suitcases to fit in. You said earlier that your EFS picked up an enemy, then it disappeared, right?"
"Yeah, but that never happens. That's why I'm pretty sure it was a glitch," I replied.
"You're not getting it. There could be more Wendigos down here."
I scoffed. "You said they rarely associate with each other unless they were turned together. I doubt there could be more than one down here."
"He also said they were strange because of the location and the rotting corpses,"
Wingnut said. "Maybe I should just let Wingnut lead our friends instead of me. I've never seen the sight of him before. Why did it start coming out now? I guess some mature stardust rubbed onto him." He was right. Moose did say something about them being weird somehow. Why couldn't those things just be textbook monsters with a weakness to regular bullets? Fire is such a complex thing to kill something with when there are so many better options. Like guns. If there are more, we would have been attacked by now, because my pip light creating a beacon that attracts death.
"Not necessarily,"
Moose said.
"Goddesses, Moose is starting to get a little annoying.
I'm beginning to see why he's the younger brother now.
If this is a pack, which is by far a strange phenomenon, we signed our death warrants when we came down here. Since they haven't attacked yet, that means they're biding their time."
This paranoia bullshit was going to be too much for me. "For what? Supposed to start screaming, 'Come eat us,' because we're too lost in the dark? They're monsters with only one thing on their minds. If there were more, we would have seen them by now, or we would have been attacked. Just because I saw a red mark on my EFS does not mean there's an enemy down here. It could have just been something up there that got out into the wasteland. Maybe it was a wasteland creature that one of the LNR snarpers took out right when I saw it pop up." Then suddenly I heard from behind me,
"Maybe it was a hanging dead guy?"
"Ah! Damn it, Squirrel! You fucking jackass!" I yelled before taking a deep breath to calm down.
"Thanks."
At least you're okay, Squirrel,
I said after recovering from the heart attack he gave me.
I'll be better when the blood isn't rushing to my head upside down like this,
he said as he tried to wiggle loose. You didn't see any other windigos besides the one that put you up here, did you? Moose asked.
Oh, sure, be a dick. No, I didn't see any more of those mangle-faced freaks besides that one,
Squirrel replied sarcastically.
Would you please cut me down?
Moose grabbed a knife and cut Squirrel down from where he was hanging and said, How the hell did you just get captured by that thing?
Losing your touch.
Last time it was that siphon and now this? Squirrel turned on his brother.
Hey, she was hot. How was I supposed to know she was crazy?
How crazy? I asked out of random curiosity.
Not the fun kind,
Squirrel said, shaking his head.
She was the fucked up, twisted kind of crazy. You know, the boiling rabbits kind.
Boiling rabbits? That's a new one. Either you're a male whore, or you're just a regular moron.
I'm proud to say that I'm both,
he replied.
What about the missing soldiers?
Wingnut asked.
Oh, they're long gone,
Squirrel replied, awkwardly and quietly. What happened? I asked, hoping it was something like they ran away or just died peacefully. Squirrel was about to speak, but Moose stopped him.
You probably don't want to know.
Most of the time, Wendigos will eat their prey alive if they haven't died before Hoof. I think it's best that we just get out of here. What if there are more than them? I asked. Moose sighed and ran his hoof through his mane.
I really don't know.
We're not equipped to deal with more than one of those things. Usually, the flare ignition guns are enough to use against Wendigos. But when there's a few of them to deal with, things get a little rough in the reloading department.
Some hunter he is. We can't leave a basement flooded with those things that take ponies in the middle of the night to eat them. We have to do something to finish the job and make sure every pony here is safe.
Listen here, short stack. I like living. Like, really like it. Staying down here with some improper weapons to use against supernatural creatures makes it kinda hard to live because of the whole, oh, I don't know, being dead thing!
Squirrel said anxiously. I've survived worse than a stupid monster like these things, I retorted. I could hear Wingnut snort out of a tiny snicker, revealing his immature side again. I can never figure that colt out.
Not just because you're lucky and don't forget all the time that you almost died from certain situations and had the gracious help of your friends to save you.
Ass, I said, getting annoyed. He sat and put his hooves up in defense.
Hey, I'm just saying that statistically, you're luckier than others.
Shadow, I don't know what you expect us to do without the proper equipment,
Moose asked. I don't know. I'm not a professional weird stuff hunter like you guys are. All I do is fight the forces of evil with my mighty horn and many guns. It's also not in my nature to leave something unfinished. You know, unless it's a really crappy book or a bad meal, I replied.
What if we blow up the basement?
Wingnut asked. Both brothers looked in surprise at his suggestion, as if they suddenly realized that they brought a young pony with them who has simple thoughts of how to get rid of something that can only be killed by fire. Although, blowing up the basement would require us to have the means to do so at the moment, which we don't. Wingnut, we don't have the explosives.
I didn't mean actually blowing it up. More like setting the entire basement on fire. We could spread the accelerant and the guns everywhere behind us as we head back towards the exit, and light it when we go out.
Wingnut clarified.
Have you seen the size of these guns, kid?
Squirrel asked arrogantly.
The liquid in these things is compressed, and it's not enough to cover entire surface area of this place. There's also the added fact that the high ceilings are here, the basement, for its former purpose. The flames wouldn't reach high enough to get the windigos if they crawled up the ceiling.
That's true and all, but what if we used gas?
Wingnut replied. What kind of gas? If this turns out to be a fart joke, I'm gonna kick your ass, I said, trying to make sure Wingnut was serious about what he was saying. Wingnut looked lost in thought for a moment.
This is a basement. Where there's a basement, there's a furnace to heat the whole place. If it heats through natural gas, we should be able to just break the valve and let it leak down here for about an hour, and have some idiot come down here and light a match.
This is one of the few reasons I didn't like him hanging around Bike. He comes up with demented plans to take care of something with the added factor of highly potential death to a stranger to whom he assumes is stupid. That's a half-good idea. But why does someone have to come down here to light a match? Couldn't we just easily shoot a flare in here to ignite it? Also, wouldn't a large amount of flammable gas in an enclosed space like this cause a massive explosion?
Oh, right,
he replied as he scratched his head.
I forgot about it possibly exploding. Of course, that's what flammable gases do when they usually are ignited like a liquid would.
He's a genius, but right now he's making himself look like a total moron. Hey Moose, is there any way to scan for or lure Wendigos?
Not really, no.
Your pitbuck is the best bet right now of detecting them, and it looks like they can hide from it. It was still nagging at me that we haven't been attacked yet. Even if there were more Wendigos, us sitting here like this would warrant an attack. I don't think most mindless monsters bide their time for that long before pouncing on their prey. Fine, we'll leave. But we need to tell the NLR that they need to seal off the basement. If we can get them to do that, maybe you guys can come back here with flamethrowers and finish the job? Squirrel looked at me like I was just that naive filly that ran out of her stable looking for answers to multiple-choice questions of life.
Do you have any idea how hard it is to find a flamethrower in the wasteland that's not in so crappy condition?
No.
It's basically like trying to rip that pitbuck off your leg without any bone saws or magical keys. If you can find one, it's usually a piece of shit and will burn you more than the thing you're trying to kill. There's a group of ponies out there who hoard flamethrowers, but they're fixed and maintain theirs. So I say we get that steppin' and say fuck this place after we get them sealed off. Maybe Wendigos can starve to death too and we just never knew it, he continued.
Fine, but I just want to say, I want it noted, that I'm not happy about any of this. If any more ponies die, then it's your fault, I said. We all started heading back towards the hole in the wall as we'd entered through, following the faded glow sticks. As we walked, Squirrel said,
I'm starting to agree with Shadow. I feel like we're failing if we don't find out if there's more down here.
Moose rolled his eyes.
I know, but we can't risk it. There's something strange about these Wendigos. The ones we killed were smarter than the others we've ran into in the past. And they're living in a different climate, too. I want to look through my book to see if there's anything that can point out what's going on here.
I'll be glad to finally be out of this basement, I said nonchalantly. I don't like wandering around in the dark. We were almost to the exit when something screamed behind us in the darkness, in the darkest part of the basement. We all turned quickly, Squirrel saying,
Perfect, now it's on our tail.
We're almost out of here. Maybe we should run for it?
Wingnut said, backing up slowly.
No chance. Those things are fast. If we run, it'll get at least one of us before it makes it back to the surface,
Moose replied.
If we could just see it, then maybe we would be able to take care of it,
Squirrel said, looking around as if he could see it creeping through the darkness. See in the dark.
Fuck, I'm a dumbass,
I replied to myself.
What do you mean?
Moose said. Digging my saddlebags, I pulled out the goggles and mask Silver gave me. I have goggles that make it so I can see in the dark. How could I forget about it? Slipping the goggles and mask on, I activated the gems on the side, and right away, the dark areas of the room came into a hazy focus. It only took a second to see the Wendigo slowly stalking closer to us. It was only a few feet away.
Shadow, do you see it?
We have to run, I said, backing up more.
That won't help, it's too fast,
Squirrel started to say. I'll keep it back. You all just need to run. I can teleport out when you're far enough away. Now run! I said, pulling out my shotgun and firing it towards the Wendigo, right as it tried to jump on Wingnut. I blasted the nasty thing right out of the air, sending it flying back into the darkness. Squirrel, Moose, and Wingnut all jumped back as I fired.
Squirrel saying, Holy shit, that was close! Shadow, we can't just leave you down here. We can torch that thing while it's down!
I watched as the Wendigo jumped back and ran for the wall, and started to run towards the ceiling. It's too fast and it's hunting us. Just run, I'll be fine.
She's right, let's go,
Moose said, picking up Wingnut and his magic and running down the hall. Squirrel not far behind. As they ran, I fired at it again, and as it tried to grab Squirrel on its way out, the Wendigo flipped around in midair and dodged the shot. When it landed, it ran towards me.
I fired again, jumping to one side as it barreled past me. It twisted around and rushed me again, screeching its ear-piercing scream. I went to the loud noise, but didn't let it disrupt me. I fired another shot as it dodged another attack, but managed to hit it in the side as it passed. The shot threw the creature back into the darkness again, and it got up and hissed at me slowly, stalking me around as if it thought I couldn't see in the dark. Maybe this thing wasn't as smart as Moose thought, or maybe it was just trying to trick me. I pulled out the flare gun again and waited for it to get closer. The fuel was low, but if I got a lucky shot, I might be able to either hurt it or distract it long enough for me to teleport out of this place. It took a few more steps closer, then crouched, readying itself for a leap. This was my chance. I lifted the flare gun ready to fire when the damned thing ran behind a pillar. I started to hear it climbing so I could get to the ceiling. I knew it couldn't fire the flare gun up there, unless I wanted to risk getting burned along with the monster. So I was smart. I took my chance to summon my magic and start to ready my teleportation spell. Right then, I saw it come around the pillar and make its way over to me. I tried to activate the spell. At the same time, the Wendigo screeched again. I winced and my hold on the spell. I swore and tried again, but the Wendigo jumped down and towards me, screeching again, making me lose hold of all my magic again. I jumped back just in time to keep it from losing my head. The second it hit the ground, it lunged at me, bullying me over. Again, I tried to call on my teleportation spell. The nasty thing put its face close to mine and screamed. This nasty breath blew its pungent scent into my nostrils, once again making me lose hold of the spell. Luckily, I didn't lose hold of my flare gun or shotgun. I brought up both to fire, but the thing jumped off me again, hissing back into the shadows. Well, if I can't teleport out of here, then let's try something different. I ran for the exit, the Wendigo screaming again and following. As I got closer to the hole in the wall, I aimed the flare gun at the ground and used the last of the fuel to cover the floor. Jumping over it and twisting around in the air, I fired the flare at the spot I covered, igniting the liquid in a second, right as I reached the other side. The Wendigo screeched and stopped on the other side of the flames. It looked at me through the fire and hissed. I snickered and stuck my tongue out at it. "I'd like to see you catch me now, bitch!" Still laughing as the Wendigo screeched again, I backed away. I started to walk towards the stairs and led up to the skyport. I was halfway down the hallway when I saw my friends waiting for me at the other end. They looked relieved to see me. Moose looked at me especially relieved and said, "Thank the goddesses. I thought it got you before you could get out." "It almost did," I said as I got closer to them. "Good thing I have a backup plan for when I couldn't get out." I heard a screech from the Wendigo again, but ignored it. Then saw my friend's eyes go wide as Wingnut yelled, "Shadow!" I turned just in time to see the Wendigo jumping through the flames, screaming as its body was singed by the heat, but the fire wasn't big enough to kill it. It landed, then charged at me. I lifted my shotgun again, but the Wendigo smacked it to one side and slammed into me. I heard my friends running to try to help me, but what could they do? They couldn't use the flare guns to stop it, not unless they wanted to risk killing me too. The Wendigo lifted one of its bladed arms, readying itself to impale me. Before it could, the raging inferno slammed into the creature. It screamed in pain as the fire covered its body, and it jumped off me. It tried to run away, but an older unicorn in a leather jacket jumped over me, with a large weapon aimed for it, and fired. A jet of fire blasted into the Wendigo again, and fell to the ground, whimpering in pain for a moment before finally letting out a last gasp and dying. The unicorn turned around then and chuckled to himself before saying, "Well, shit. What the fuck was so hard about that? That you two numbnuts couldn't do it? I thought I showed both you little dipshits how to take down a Wendigo when you were still colts. You got rusty on me, or trying to get killed on purpose? I mean, damn. What's so hard about bringing a fucking flamethrower or learning a fire spell?"
Hex looked even more smug than he had when I had helped him fight the ghouls back near the Twin Cities. I got back to my hooves and shivered a little after the attack.
"Damn, Hex, talk about good timing."
He looked at me for a moment like he was confused. Then he grinned his jackass smile.
"Shadow Star, right?
Didn't think I'd find you down here with my sons. Thought you were helping out the kingdom or something."
Squirrel and Moose both came up next to me. Wingnut staying behind as Squirrel said,
"Dad, where the hell have you been? We haven't seen you in a year. We thought you died." "I've been hunting for the Demon Slayer, like I told you two tit suckers I was.
What else could I be doing? Tracking down all the Wendigos from here to Minneapolis, but it slipped away again. The damned mystery pony is a fucking nightmare to track down, Hex said. Moose looked irritated by the old unicorn. Then why are you back here? Did you finally give up in trying to find it? He looked over at me and grinned. Nah, I heard something about him being spotted around New Pegasus, and figured I'd come here to see if you two assats were still hanging around this dump. Well, I'm glad you came by when you did, I said. I heard from the commander here that my shithead sons were taking care of some creatures for the NLR down here, so I thought I'd make sure they weren't fucking it up. And guess what? They were. It's just so hard to create competent offspring in these times we live in.
Moose walked back up the hallway.
Whatever. I'm gonna go let the commander know we took care of the Wendigos.
I watched him go, then asked, what's his problem?
He doesn't care to be around our dad, Squirrel said. Hey, Pops, what are you gonna do now that you're back? From the looks of it, I'll have to help you two learn how to hunt again. Can't believe you two left this little gal back there to defend herself. It was her idea, not ours, he argued.
Mungnut walked closer to Hex.
Hey, that's a cool jacket. Where'd you get it?
Hex looked down at him.
Took it off some pony who pissed me off at a bar in Manhattan.
Cool,
Wingnut said, his eyes going bigger.
So, you taught Squirrel and Moose how to be hunters? Can you teach me?
His grin got even bigger.
I'm sure I could. I always say there needs to be more hunters in the wasteland.
Picking Wingnut up in my magic, I pulled him away from Hex. No way. Becoming a hunter's the last thing you need to do.
Ah, but Shadow, he's so cool, look at him!
Wingnut complained.
He's also a dick,
Squirrel said, looking at his father. Hex just laughed.
Yep, it's true, I am a dick and proud of it. Anyway, I have a question now that I've run into you again, Shadow.
Oh yeah? What's that?
When I met you before, something seemed off about you. Now that I'm seeing you again, I'm sure right. You got something living inside you, don't you?
He asked.
Oh, what gave it away? Do I give off some evil presence, or was it just my stunning new look?
I mocked. Honestly, I was a little worried he was going to pick up on that so easily.
Both. I live to kill things that go bump in the night, or the day, it doesn't matter.
He replied with a grin.
My dear, you definitely aren't normal. The question is, what are you?
Squirrel put a hoof on Hex's shoulder.
Dad, back off. She's cool. Shadow's been making a name for herself around here as of late. She's not a danger to any pony.
He started to laugh again.
Oh, she's dangerous, that's for sure. But how dangerous?
I rolled my eyes again. Thanks again for the quick save, Hex. But I'm not here to be interrogated by you. Come on, Wingnut. Let's go.
Shadow? Are you sure you're okay? You didn't just almost get killed by that Wendigo?
He asked as we walked past Hex and Squirrel. Yeah, I'm fine, I replied. Hex chuckled again.
You remind me of another pony I met a few months back. She had quite the attitude like you do.
Something Mom said to me yesterday came back to me. Said something about a pony named Hex being one who messed with my memories. Turning back towards him, I asked, what was her name? He smiled wider.
Spell or something like that. She lived in some rundown shack near that town with a big-ass wall. Why do you know her?
So what if I do? What I want to know is, what did you do to her? I asked as I slowly drew Dreamwalker.
Whoa there, Shadow, calm down,
Squirrel said, putting a hoof up.
You really don't want to be drawing your weapon around my pops.
Quiet. I believe the young lady wants an answer to her question, Hex said, tossing the flamethrower aside and pulling his bat off his back.
I'm gonna warn you now, kid. If you want answers, you shouldn't start by pulling out your weapon. All that does is tell me you want to fight, and that pisses me the fuck off.
I want to know what you did to my mom. She's forgotten almost everything about her past and had those memories replaced with false ones. The only thing she remembers is running into you.
Ah, yes. Well, you see, I ran into her because I heard a rumor she knew where I could find that mysterious pony. All I wanted to know was where he was and how I could get his gun.
Funny thing is that when I started questioning her about him, she got very defensive. So I did what any pony would do in the situation. I threatened her. She didn't like that one bit, and she attacked me. We got into a fight, one that I must say almost led her to kill me, but I was able to fend her off in the end, though. I told her that I wanted to know everything she knew about the pony and the dream, Demon Slayer. Do you know what she said she tried to do to me? Hex said, slowly walking closer to me, his bat swinging back and forth. I'm sure she tried to attack you again. That sounds like something she'd do, I said, taking a step back. Oh, she did more than that. She tried to cast a powerful memory spell on me. I think she wanted to try to make me forget everything, everything I knew about the mysterious pony and his gun. Luckily for me, I have wards around myself to stop spells like that from working. When that failed, I knew I wasn't going to get what I wanted out of her. Since I had a small bit of respect for how good of a fight she put up, I didn't want to kill her either. So I used this. He pulled out a small stone from his saddlebags. It was shaped like an eye with a glowing green around it. Part of the glow looked like an eye, with three triangles over it and a couple of swirls under that. What the hell is that thing? Squirrel asked. Still looking at me, Hex said, This is a very old relic that took me some years to find. It's called the Memory Stone. It used to belong to a unicorn named Clover the Clever. I figured that pony meant a lot to her. So I wanted to take away the memories of that pony as a way to punish her for her bad attitude. I'll admit that I acted quickly so the spell the stone cast wasn't up to par with what it can normally do. Who would have thought the thing she cared about most was her daughter? My eyes went wide as I pointed Dreamwalker right at his head. Give me the stone. Why should I do that, huh? Because of what you did, my mom has gone crazy. She thinks I'm dead and she's going to do a lot of bad things because of it. I need to fix her memory. If that thing broke her memory, then I'm sure I can fix it, I yelled.
Shadow, calm down,
Wingnut said, trying to pull me back. Hex just laughed, however.
Sorry, kid, doesn't work like that. True, the memory stone is the only thing that could fix her memory. If you'd have run into me a few days after I'd used it. But sadly, it's too late.
I lowered Dreamwalker a little, my eyes going wide.
What do you mean?
He put the stone back into his saddlebags.
I mean that after 3 days, the memory loss can't be fixed. Not even with this. No matter what you do, she'll never get back those memories she lost. As for the ones that replaced the old ones, that wasn't from the stone. Either her mind filled with the blanks of she didn't remember, or a spell of hers did it.
What the fuck, Dad? You took away Sifoni's memories just because she pissed you off?
Squirrel asked, sounding disgusted with Hex. Hex just shrugged.
Hey, at least I didn't kill her.
You motherfucker! I yelled, lifting Dreamwalker again. I'll kill you! Before I could fire, Hex flipped his bat around and slammed Dreamwalker out of my magic hold, then kicked me in the chest, knocking me to the ground, then pointing the end of his back at my face. His grin was gone, and he looked almost angry.
Listen here, kid. I did what I did a while ago, and I'm sorry that your mom forgot you. But if she would have just told me what I wanted to know instead of attacking me, then this wouldn't have happened.
Leave her alone!
Wingnut yelled. Without even looking at the colt, Hex said,
Stay out of this, kid.
Then he continued.
Trying to kill me will only lead to you dying. Now I suggest you forget about all that's happened to your mom. She's fucked up because of losing her memories of you, and that has nothing to do with me. It just means that she's always been like this. And you were the only thing she was living for. I know the spell didn't take everything away from her, so if you really want to save her, then the only thing you can do is make her believe that you're her daughter. Find a way to show her that you are who you say you are. And if that doesn't work, then kill her. Because no matter what you do, she won't get back the memories she lost. It's better to put her out of her misery. When you try to fix something that's broken with glue, there's always little cracks left over.
She was waiting for me to come out of my stable so I could help her with her mission. She waited for 8 years, and only a few months before I was finally old enough to leave, you fuck it all up? For what? So you get some stupid revolver? You're a fucking monster! I yelled. I was so angry, so hurt by what he said. I could feel the power of Aquila building inside me,
wanting nothing more than to turn that grinning asshole into a burnt husk. I didn't let it out, though. I had no idea what would happen if I did. Then I remembered that while I was using Aquila's power before, I was able to force a memory out of Mom. And that made me have a little bit of hope, as I said. You're wrong.
Wrong about what?
He asked. I ran into her yesterday. I was able to cast a memory spell on her, just a moment. And she did remember one thing about what happened in our stable. Either that rock you have isn't the real thing, or you're lying.
And that's not possible. No power on Equus can bring back memories taken by the memory stone,
he said, sounding more irritated than before.
You can try fooling yourself into whatever you want. Either way, I'm finished here.
He put the bat away and picked up his flamethrower. As he did, Squirrel asked,
Where do you think you're going, Dad?
Heading to Crossroads Trading Post.
I have a gun to fi-
Hex stopped and looked back at me.
Wait a minute. A second ago you said something about me trying to get a revolver. How did you know about the Demon Slayer's a revolver?
Getting back to my hooves, I looked at him with anger written on my face. Get out of here, Hex! Because if you don't, I swear to Luna that I'll bake you like a rotten corpse on the desert floor.
He pulled the bat off his back again. Damn, here I thought I was finished, but I guess I was wrong. Should have known that if your little mommy dearest knew about that gun and the stallion who has it, that you would too. Tell me what you know before I'm forced to show you what I did to her after I took her memory away. Dad, trust me. You should go. Now's not a good time to be pissing her off.
Squirrel said, pulling out his own pistol.
I don't want to do this, but I'm not going to watch as you try to hurt a friend of mine. Shut up, Squirrel. You know you can't do anything to stop me. Now tell me, Shadow Star. Where's that gun?
He said as he walked back towards me again.
If you know about it, and your mother... I'm sure your daddy isn't far behind. Assumingly, you aren't immaculated conceived, because that would be a load of mule shit. I'm sure good old Pops knows about it, doesn't he?
I could feel her power building again, and it was getting harder to push it down. If you couldn't get that information out of my mom, then you won't get out of me either. He stopped.
Oh, now what's this I see? Ah, there is something lurking deep inside of you. I can see it in your eyes. Something angry lives inside of you, doesn't it? Something that wants control. Let me see it, Shadow Star. Let me see that darkness that wants to rip me apart, so I can show you my job and kill it. Then, once that's done, I'll get the information I need from you.
Wingnut was pulling on one of my forelegs, saying,
Shadow, calm down! If you don't, you're gonna do something bad again. You don't want to do that, do you?
I want him dead, Wingnut. Everything that's happened to my mom is because of him. All over a stupid gun. He was laughing now.
Yeah. Tell me how much you hate me, Shadow. Because I really want to see that thing that's living inside of you. Show me what you really are.
If he wanted to see what Aquila really was, then fine. He was about to be in for a big fucking surprise. Right as Hex lifted the bat, I was about to let the power inside of me out. A shot rang out from old Festus. A bullet flew through one of Hex's leg, making him lose his magical hold on his bat. He fell to the floor, looking shocked for a moment.
The fuck? You little shit stain!
He said as he looked down at his bleeding leg. Wingnut put a hoof on my head and made me look down at him, pressing his forehead against mine, ignoring Hex.
Shadow, calm down, and listen to me. Killing him won't fix what happened to her. He's trying to get in your head and make you let Aquila out. Don't give that to him. You don't want another incident like Mill City Tower, do you?
I felt my heart rate drop, the power and anger inside my fading away.
No, I don't want that to happen to me again.
Squirrel moved over to me and put a hoof to my shoulder.
The kid's right. My dad's not worth it. He's just a has-been. I'll show you as a has-been,
Hex said, getting back up and picking up his bat.
I want to know where I can find that gun, and what's inside of her.
He didn't get a chance to say anything anymore, because a moment later, Moose grabbed Hex and slammed him to a wall of the tunnel. Using his own magic, he ripped the bat away from his father and tossed it down the tunnel.
Get out of here! We don't need you in here, and as for this...
He ripped Hex's saddlebags away and pulled out the memory stone.
I think something like this shouldn't be in the hooves of a pony like you. Get out of here before I tell the NLR what you just tried to do to a pony they have a lot of respect for.
To my shock, Hex just laughed.
Fine. Have it your way. I always knew you two didn't have the balls to be real hunters. If you did, you'd have killed that mare when you first met her. She's a demon, and a nasty one at that.
Moose picked his father up and threw him down the tunnel after his bat.
The only demon here is you. You have no idea what you're talking about or what's inside Shadow. Not even every supernatural thing in the wasteland is evil. If you took the time to learn more about what you hunted instead of killing them first, you'd know that.
X picked himself up, and then picked up the bat and put it back onto his back. He held his wounded leg off the floor slightly, and sighed.
Or maybe I just know more than you. But that's fine. If you want to learn the hard way, I won't stop you. I can still get what I want in other ways. Yeah, I'm sure you can, Squirrel said, walking over to stand next to his brother. But I suggest you stay away from us and our friends! If we see you again, you won't get off so lucky.
He looked over at me and grinned.
Should've let the Wendigo eat you, I guess. Oh well, at least this was an interesting day. See you again, Shadow Star. Oh, and thank that kid of yours. Aquila, huh? Now, I wonder what on Equus Aquila is.
Before any of us could do anything, Hex vanished with a flash of light. The brothers looked back at me, and Moose asked,
You okay, Shadow?
I am now,
I said, and pointed at the saddlebags that Moose was holding. That stone he had. Was he telling the truth about what it can do? Moose looked down at the memory stone.
I'm not sure, but we have a few books here written by Clover the Clever. I'll see if we can learn something about this thing. I know I've seen a drawing of it here, at least, in one of the books or a scroll.
Clover the Clever is pretty ancient.
Leave it up to my brother. You'll figure it out.
Squirrel said, walking over and panting, patting the top of my head.
Sorry our dad's such a dick.
It's fine. At least I had Wingnut here to keep me calm.
I'm sorry I said Aquila's name, though. Now Hex is going to try to figure out what she is.
Wingnut said, looking ashamed. He ruffled my mane.
He can look all he wants, but I don't think he's going to find much. Even if he does, he can't do anything about her.
He smiled a little.
Okay, so can we get out of here now? That thing stinks.
Squirrel and Moose and myself all laughed as I said,
Yeah, good idea.
Let's go. As we walked out of the tunnel, I thought to myself that there still had to be a way to fix Mom. I was able to make her remember one thing. That was because I was using Aquila's power at the time. Hex said no power on Equus could make her remember. It's a good thing I had a power that wasn't of our world. Aquila's power was something more. If I worked at it, I'm sure I could make her remember me. If not, then the only thing left was to convince her that I was her little star.
So, let me get this straight. That unicorn we saw in the Midwest was Squirrel and Moose's dad? He was also the one who made your mom forget you?
When Thrasher asked. I'd just gotten done explaining what had happened with the rest of my friends as we waited for the NLR commander's office. He was still talking to Squirrel and Moose just outside about the Wendigos. Aura was sitting in one corner telling Wingnut about how angry she was that he'd gotten into a situation like he did. Stardust was still in shock that an old stone could screw with a mare's head as much. And Windthrasher was still asking me all the questions.
Yeah, Moose thinks there might be more to the stone than Hex said. He's going to look into it more and let me know if the effects can be reversed, I replied.
Talking about your family gives me a headache, Stardust said.
Next thing you know, we're going to find out you have a sibling that rules the Crystal Empire and wants you dead. Fuck your family and everything they stand for. If I didn't have to go to Los Alicorn to help Mr. Tops, I'd just say forget about the whole family. But I'm not sure having to go deal with her no matter what, I said. Aura looked over at us.
For now, this is what we're going to do. The celebration at Crimson Canyon is tomorrow. And that's all that matters right now. And when it comes to Mr. Tops, I say we just do the job and hope we don't run into your mom, the Sins, or the damned Enclave while we're there. Hell, I hope we don't see the Steel Rangers there either, because fuck all of that.
I smiled a little. Yeah, I agree. Let's finish up and then get going.
Damn, that didn't take much convincing,
Aura said. Because you're right, Aura, I said, smiling. Windthresher yawned a little.
I just hope this doesn't take too long.
Stardust yawned as well.
I agree.
The door to the office opened, and an Earth Pony Stallion walked in.
Thank you for waiting. I'm Commander Redwood, and I lead the new Pegasus branch of the new Lunar Republic. How can I help you all today?
I shrugged. Honestly, I'm not sure. You're captain at Crossroads Trading Post, said I should stop by and talk to you. I'm Shadowstar, the courier. I'm sure you've heard about me on the radio. He walked around to sit at his desk.
Oh, that's right. She sent me a report about what happened yesterday. Said you might be stopping by. I believe she wanted me to see about you joining us. Although from the other reports I've gotten about you, I'm sure I won't be able to convince you. Even though I'm sure you would make a good addition to the ranks.
Yeah, you've got that right. So, if that's all she wanted me to meet you for then, I should get going. We have to get to the Crimson Canyon. I said, getting up.
Crimson Canyon, huh? Well, I might not be able to convince you to join the NLR, but there could be something that you might be able to help me with if you're headed to Crimson Canyon. He said, as if he didn't want me to leave yet. Do you know a griffin named Apollo?
Aura looked at Commander Redwood.
Sure we do. He's my father. Why?
The commander looked back at her.
Ah, well, you see, he's been working with us as of late to help gather intel on the Romans, but lately we haven't gotten any reports from him. If you're heading that way, would you be able to get a message to him letting him know that we need the latest intel on what he's been able to gather?
Aura snickered a little.
He's probably been busy helping set up for the rebirth celebration. I'm sure when it's all over he'll be able to help you out.
I thought as much too. We know all about the celebration, but the problem is it's been 3 weeks since we've last heard from him. Even stranger is that the griffins that I know don't work for the Red Talons have been dropping in and leaving messages for him with one of my lieutenants. I don't like it, so I want him to come here and explain what's going on. We have a contact with the Red Talons, not the other groups.
Redwood asked. What other groups? I asked.
I'm not sure who they work for, but they aren't a Talon group, I know. So, can you talk to him for me?
It shouldn't be a problem, I said, confused. Was there anything else, or was that all? Bite looked over at us, saying,
This is all fun and all, but can we go? I don't like being here.
The commander chuckled a little.
No, not today at least. Maybe one day soon I'll have something for you, soon enough, Shadow. I've been hearing things about a pony who says he used to work for Equestria Express, who's been making trouble north of here. I don't know a lot of intel yet, but seeing how you are the Equestria Express now, I might have you look into it. Even though you don't work for us, that doesn't mean I can't hire you for a job, right?
I know Boxtape said he had a courier that hadn't returned from a job when I first started working for him. Maybe this is the same pony? If you get more information, just let me know, or let Squirrel and Moose know. They'll get the message to me. At the very least, I'd like to meet this pony so I can tell him what happened to Boxtape. Even if some pony is saying he's causing trouble. Hell, there are ponies around here who think that I make trouble, I replied. Wingnut started to laugh.
That's because you do, Shadow.
Shut up, I said, doing my best to ignore him.
Commander Redwood smiled. I'll see what I can dig up. Thanks again for meeting with me. Also thank you and your cold friend for helping out with those monsters.
We left not long after that. We didn't see Moose or Squirrel on our way out, but I'm sure that they were either looking into what happened in the basement to make sure those Wendigos showed up, or finding something to eat. We made our way out of JetBlue Skyport and started heading towards Crimson Canyon. We avoided getting close to Stable 14 when we left, since it was being used by the survivors of Appleton. We figured it was best not to be seen by them right now. The trip to Crimson Canyon from the Skyport wasn't that long, so we decided to walk would do us some good. And it kept Stardust from complaining about having to carry one of us, specifically me. As we walked, I noticed that Aura was muttering something to herself.
You okay, Aura?
Yeah. Why?
She replied, as if distracted from a daydream.
You keep muttering something under your breath,
Biter said, who was walking just the other side of the griffin.
So what?
She replied. Are you angry about something? I asked.
She rolled her eyes. No, I'm not. I'm just going over something I have in my head that I might do during the celebration.
I cocked my head to the side.
Like what?
We aren't going to start any fights while we're there, are we? She laughed.
No, not unless one of the griffins wants to, that is. It's just something I want to do for the performance part of the celebration, is all.
What sort of performance? Stardust asked curiously.
None of your business. You'll just have to wait and see,
she said with a cocky grin.
I've been wondering about what's going to happen during this,
Wingnut said.
I'd like to know that too,
Windthrasher added. Aura looked thoughtful for a moment.
The celebration itself goes on for 3 days. The first day, we have the open ceremony, where there'll be a singing, dancing, lots of drinking. The first day and night is when we remember the birth of the Red Talons, and dedicate the night part of it in remembrance of Greta and our family who's led the Red Talons since it started. The second day is when we have sparring matches. Those are so younger griffins can prove themselves. Disputes can be settled, and even griffins from other talon groups can use this as a chance to prove they're worthy to join the Red Talons. That night, I'm sure we'll see a few griffins decide to form a life bond. Those are always a lot of fun to watch. On the other last day, we take time to remember those that we lost over the year. Also, Tonto will tell a story from our past and talk about rebirth and all that. It's also the only time that another can challenge the leader of the Red Talons to take over as the new leader.
You mean that it's possible for another griffin to take over the Red Talons?
Windthrasher asked.
Yeah, but I'm not too worried. My family has always proven to be the strongest griffins around. In the last 12 years, my mom's led the Talons. Only 2 griffins have tried to fight her, and both times she won.
Aura answered. I'm guessing one of those was Gina? I asked.
No. One of them was some young griffin the year after Mom took over. The second was my uncle, Apollo's brother.
Aura replied again. Damn, I didn't know Apollo had a brother, I said.
He did,
Aura said. Wingnut gave her a sorrowful look.
He did? What happened to your uncle?
He paid the price for trying to take over his leader. He died. The battle for leadership is a fight to the death. Mercy can be given if the griffin loses and the winner doesn't think that there'll be a threat. But Mom does never like looking weak. She never shows mercy. I'm just hoping this year she doesn't get another challenger.
If she's only had 2 griffins challenge her, I'm sure the odds are low, Windthrasher said.
Most years, yes, but with what's going on with the Unchained Talons, the battle's breaking out, and Mom's sending griffins to help ponies without payment, she might have a few angry griffins that want to take over this year.
Well, let's make sure that doesn't happen, I said, giving her a smile. She smiled back as we continued on. We all walked in silence for a while. Then I could make out the town just outside of Crimson Canyon. I walked closer to Aura and asked, Remember when your father did that speech for a box tape and he said something about his children? You said that Sin wasn't his daughter, and that you'd tell me about that later? So Sin isn't your sister, or is adopted, or what? Aura smiled sadly.
She's my half-sister. Apollo wasn't my mom's first partner. I'm not sure if I told you this or not, but griffins are different from ponies when it comes to who we spend our lives with. We don't do weddings, and or we have what you call marriage. We believe that there's only one soul that we are meant to spend our mortal lives with. When we find that griffin, we form a life bond, and that griffin is the one, the only one, that we'll spend the rest of our lives with. Before my mom was with my dad, she was in a life bond with another griffin named Grant. Sadly, he was killed not long after my mom had Sin.
If that's true, then why is she with Apollo? I asked.
Normally, when the griffin you have a life bond with dies, you never look for another griffin. Mom would have been just fine with that, because from what I knew about Grant, she loved him with all of her heart. And the problem is, the leader of the Red Talons is expected to have a partner, and to have more than one child to keep the bloodline of the Talons alive. With Gina gone and Grail dead, she was the last one, so she ended up with my dad. Since my mom can no longer be in a life bond, they decided to get married in the pony way, for political reasons.
Aura explained. So Apollo and Gigi don't love each other? I asked. Aura smiled again.
They do. But not in the same way as most griffins would if they were together like my parents are. They both lost the griffin. They felt that way for and made this new union work.
So Apollo lost his soulmate too? I asked.
Yeah. He was about to form a life bond with my Aunt Gail before Gina killed her.
Damn. And I thought my family was messed up, I said.
It is, but that doesn't mean the rest of us don't have our own problems, too. Apollo's good, and he does want to make my mom happy. And they may not share the same feelings as they did with their old partners, but it works.
So why does Sin call him Dad if he's not her father? I asked.
Because to Sin, Apollo is her father. She was raised by him just like the rest of us. He loves her like the rest of us.
We were just getting into town when I started to see some of the ponies from Cartwheel coming towards us. Following them was a few griffins from the Red Talons. I saw Vervain not far behind some of them, giving me a big smile as she started to trot towards me. I smiled back at her, happy to be seeing her again, even if we were only parting ways a few days ago. With everything that's been going on as of late, I had so much to talk to her about. Well, be that as it may, looks like we have a welcoming party. How about we all go say hi? I said.
Sounds like a plan, Stardust said.
I'm glad to see that the Cartwheel survivors made it here okay. I was about to say something when Fletch landed in front of us, her two lackeys, Pluck and Groger, not far behind. She pulled her spear off her back, pointing it at Aura, and said,
Hey, sis. Glad you could make it here on the eve of the rebirth celebration. Put that thing away, Fletch. You know I was invited here. And even if I wasn't, I have every right to be here during this time. This is the one time a year that a banished griffin can go back to Crimson Canyon.
Aura said, ruffling her feathers a little. Sin, Eris, and Gigi all landed. Gigi looking at her second youngest daughter, saying,
Fletch, put that spear down and let your sister in. I invited her, and you know the rules.
Fletch didn't move. She just smiled, saying,
Mom, today's the eve of the rebirth. As you said, I know the rules, and that goes for the one that says that on the eve of rebirth, I have every right to request a duel with some griffins that I don't think is worthy of being part of tomorrow's celebration. Seeing how Aura has already tried to say she's stronger than me, and seeing how she dishonored the name Blood Talon, I challenge her to a one-on-one fight in the arena. If she wins, then I'll let her pass and forget what she did. If I win, Aura has to admit that I'm stronger and promise never to step Talon back in our lands ever again, and to give up her right as a freelance griffin.
Fuck that, Fletch.
I don't need to prove myself to you,
Aura said angrily.
Oh, yes, you do, little sis. If you turn down this request, every pony in the area will know you're a coward,
Fletch said, still grinning. Gigi pushed the spear down.
I'm not going to watch my daughters fight in the arena over your pride, Fletch.
Fletch ripped the spear back and glared at her mother.
It's not about pride, Mother. It's about our family's honor. Also, it doesn't matter what you say. You can't stop a duel today. This is an old tradition that goes all the way back to the beginning of our Talon Company. Now I'm asking you, Aura,
she said, turning back to give her sister eyes.
Do you accept? Are you going to run away again and prove that you really are a coward? Fletch, you know that I'm the better fighter. Always have been. Always will be,
Aura said. Gigi sighed and looked at Aura, too.
I'm sorry, Aura, but Fletch has a point. I can't stop her from doing this.
That's crap, I said. You're the leader here, not Fletch.
Be quiet, Shadow. Let me deal with this,
Aura said, getting closer to Fletch.
Fine. If you want to do this, then let's do this. And when I win, I want you to leave the Red Talons yourself and try living your life as a freelancer.
Fletch's smile just got bigger as she moved even closer to her sister, then said in a voice so quiet I could barely hear her,
And when I win, I'm going to show you how weak a pony lover really is. You have no idea how much stronger I've gotten since our last fight, little sister.
She got even quieter.
And when I win, I'm going to make sure you never see that mare slut of yours ever again.
Footnote. Level up. New perk added. Supernatural. For all the things that go bump in the night, and sometimes the day, the supernatural perk is unique. You may not regularly run into these monsters in the wasteland, but you've gained the ability to sense the presence of nearby supernatural creatures. Although this perk excludes demons, ghosts, ghouls born of radiation, and some star spirits.